حدث مولانا ذو الفقارة والتعب والشيخة طريقة عالم رباني صاحب نسبة بذرب. He has been to our country on quite a few occasions and therefore he does not really require any introduction. But it is our good fortune to have people of his caliber amongst us, even if they visit us for a little while. These people, when they travel about, they do not only just go and give speeches. It is that nur of taqwa, that nur of that nisbat ma'allah which they have in their heart, which they also take along with them, and they enlighten or they remove the darkness from those areas which they visit. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has kept a ta'seer and an effect in their speeches and bayans, because their speeches and bayans are not just words which flow from their lips. It is something that comes out from their heart. So Hazrat Maulana, our very honored and respected guest, is a principal of Darul Ihsan and Darul Uloom in New York, and also many madrasas he is a patron, and he has traveled the length and breadth of many countries, especially what was in those days called the Soviet Union. Hazrat Maulana has thousands of murids in many parts of the world, and something that was unique, I'm not going to really give a full introduction of, because you are aware and familiar and you have had the opportunity of listening to Hazrat Maulana in the past, but something that really impressed me when I was in New York is to meet very elderly people, some in their 40s, 50s or 60s, and when you meet them and you ask them, what are you doing? And somebody says, I'm doing hifz of the Quran Sharif. Somebody says that I am becoming an alim and I am doing Mishkat Sharif. Someone says that I am doing Bukhari Sharif. In other words, they were doing the full alim course when they were already at that age that we would think that this person now, what has he got left in him that he's going to do some studies of deen. And then the unique part was that these were not just ordinary people who had nothing else to do. They were retired and they were relaxing and they had nothing else to do, so they were doing kitab. With the bayan and with the encouragement of Hazrat Maulana Shamat Barakatuhum and his majlises of Talim and Tarbiyah, these were people who were engineers, who were doctors, who were teachers, registrar of university. Now these are the type of people that were now engaged in seeking the knowledge of deen after they had gone to their professions and returned. Now they were seeking the knowledge of deen and they were becoming ulama. Maulana had a very special course that was planned for them and chalked for them, and they were doing this course and alhamdulillah they were making tremendous progress. Now this was something unique. So I was informed that Hazrat Maulana encouraged them that how long are you going to wait for English-speaking ulama to come to your country? Why don't you who are here, who have got qualifications, who have got degrees in the secular field, now become ulama, even if it takes you a longer time because you are going to do it on a part-time basis? So Hazrat Maulana has been making an extensive effort and he has been traveling throughout the world with this burning heart of his. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala light up our hearts also with the nur of taqwa. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala bless us also with that nisbat that Allah ta'ala has blessed his mashayikh with.
Alhamdulillah wa taqwa. وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قد أفلح من تزكى، وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر، ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها، قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر ومن تزكى فإنما يتزكى لنفسه وإلى الله المصير. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر فلا تزكوا أنفسكم هو أعلم بمن اتقى. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر ولولا فضل الله عليكم ورحمته ما زكى منكم من أحد أبدا ولكن الله يزكي من يشاء. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. قد أفلح من تزكى. This is a verse of Quran that the person who got tazkiya, he achieved the success, the falah. There are two important words which have been used in this verse. One is falah and the other one is tazkiya. Falah is a Quranic word and it means opening of a secret thing. For example, the farmer who cultivates the land is called fallah because he cultivates the land and vegetable, the crop, come out from the earth. Similarly, a person whose teeth are not properly shaped and he cannot close his mouth, whose lips remain open, is called rajulun aflaha. So fallah means opening of the hidden thing, opening of the secret thing. And in Quranic language it means that on the day of judgment, the reward of the mu'mineen of their amal will be opened by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they will get the falah. Falah means a success, that after that, the final and ultimate success, the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is called falah. And in Quran, it has been linked with three things. Number one, it has been linked with tawbah. وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. So with the help of tawbah, we can get the falah. Then number two, it has been linked with tazkiyah. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى. The person who achieved tazkiyah, he got the falah. And number three, it has been linked with the prayer, with the namaz, with salat. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. But the Mufassireen, they have explained it that there is a link in between all of these three. So the person who will make true tawbah and get the tazkiyah enough, and then he will pray the namaz, salat with khushu, he will get the falah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are three stages. Everyone has to make tawbatun nasuh. This is first step. Then he has to achieve tazkiyah enough. Second step. Then the third step is to pray the salat with khushu and khuzu. And before taking the first step,
you cannot achieve the second one. And without achieving the second step, you cannot achieve the third one. There is an order. A person who has not made tawbah, he cannot achieve tazki enough. And the person who has no tazki enough, he cannot pray with khushu and khudu. So there is an order. So there are three steps, and basically it is a route towards the salah. So the person who will make salat, tawbatun nasuh, and he will make efforts to achieve tazki enough, and then he will pray the namaz, salat with khushu and khudu, he will get the final salah, success from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world and in the day, on the day of judgment. Then the second word is tazkiya. Tazkiya means to purify the inner self. One word is called tazkiya. Tazkiya is the cleanliness. And tazkiya is to purify. There is a difference in between the two. For example, if there is a dust on the glass, you just clean, wipe it with the help of a cloth, and it becomes clean. It is cleaning process. It is tazkiya of the glass. Because the dust did not penetrate in the glass, it was a layer on the glass. So you wiped it out, it became clean. But if the clothes of some person, they became dirty, can they be cleaned with the help of wiping with something? No. There is another process, which is called washing. So by washing the cloth, we can purify, we can separate dust from the cloth. This is called tazkiya of the cloth. So that's why, for the nafs, the word tazkiya is used, and for the heart, the word tazkiya is used. So tazkiya a qalb, and tazkiya a nafs. Because these pollutions are inside the nafs. If you read Quran, you can find the proof that these diseases are inside the nafs. Let me quote few of them. For example, shahwa. They are inside the nafs. Proof from Quran. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ. It proves that shahwat are in the nafs of the person, number one. Then hawa. We say hawa-e nafsani. They are inside the nafs. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. So Quran is telling us that hawa-e nafsani, they are connected with the nafs of the person. Then number three, bukhl, shuh, is also connected with the nafs of a person. From Quran, وَأُحْذِرَتِ الْأَنفُسُ الشُّحْ. So it means that shuh is connected with the nafs of a person. Then safahat is also connected with the nafs of a person. إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسَهُ. It is also connected with the nafs of a person. And then hasad, jealousness, is also connected with the nafs of a person. حَسَدًا مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. So this jealousness is also connected with the nafs. And takabbur is also connected with the nafs. From Quran, Azim al-Shan, لَقَدِ اسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. Subhanallah. All of these diseases, they are connected with the nafs, and the proof is from Quran. So it means we have to purify our nafs from these bad diseases. That is called the tazkiya of the nafs. It is such an important task that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has suborned 7 times before telling that the falah is in the tazkiya nafs. When some elderly person, he says something, it means that is important. And if he swears in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's a proof. It's very important. And if we swear 2 times, it is very, very important. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, greatest of all, He is swearing in his name. How many times? 7 times. There is no other place in Quran where so much emphasis has been placed. It is such an important task. Read the Quran, Azim al-Shan. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا وَالسَّمَاءِ وَمَا بَنَاهَا وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا طَحَاهَا وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Such an important objective, and we remain ghafil from there? So strange. It's very important to achieve tazkiyah nafs. It was one of the objective with which Rasulullah he came in this world. There were 4 basic objectives. When Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhislam, he built the Kaaba, then he made dua, "Oh Allah, I have built a masjid, send someone to worship there. I have built a madrasa, so we need a teacher, send a significant teacher for madrasa." He made a dua. And then he said and quoted 4 objectives. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. So he quoted 4 objectives. For that, this significant teacher is required. And Rasulullah ﷺ, he said that I am the dua of my forefather Ibrahim ﷺ. So he came with the same 4 objectives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quoted these objectives in Quran. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. But then there is a difference in the 2 places. Why? The word tazkiyah, which was used by Ibrahim alayhi salam, it was on the 4th place. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he described the objective, he put it on the 2nd place. Now this change of order in Quran gives us a message. Quran Azim al-Shan is such a beautiful book that any word which has been used at any place has its own secrets and importance. Even when 2 words, they are used one after the other, they have a secret inside. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he changed the order, it means there is a message for us. Let me quote one example. In Quran, the words have been used. هَلَا تَعَالَ الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا إِنَّا خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ أَمْشَاجٍ نَبْتَلِيهِ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. So these 2 words have been used. فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. The word سَمَاعَتْ has been used first, and the word basira has been used afterwards. Now we take it very normal, but still there is a secret. There was a scientist from New York. He wrote a very good research paper. Analysis of the holy verses in the light of modern sciences. This was the topic of his paper. Analysis of the holy verses in the light of modern sciences. He quoted 14 verses from Quran and then analyzed them in the light of the modern sciences. And he proved that all of these verses, whatever they told, was 100% correct. He wrote his paper and he read the paper in a seminar where there were more than 400 scientists. Luckily, I was there in New York at that time, so I happened to read that paper. I got a chance to read that paper. No, out of these 14 verses, Alhamdulillah, I can quote all of these 14 verses and explain it. But I would prefer if the audience will be engineers and doctors. But one verse was this, فَجْعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيًّا بَصِيرًا. He quoted this verse and he said that when I read Quran, then I came out with the conclusion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that we bless the human being with the sama'at and with the basarat. So it came in my mind, why sama'at has been preferred on the basarat? It has been mentioned ahead of the basarat. There might be a reason. So let me make a research on that. So he said, I made a research for more than 3 years. How the baby takes a birth in the womb of the mother. And then I came up with the conclusion that the first organ which is made in the body of the baby is the ears of the baby. First organ, before eyes, before lips, before heart, before everything, the first organ which is made completely in the body of the baby are the ears of the baby. Why? There is a reason for that. Because in the ear, there are canals. And in the canal, there is liquid. And with this liquid, we keep the balance of our head. Now ask question from yourself. How do we keep our head straight? Do we look at our face, our head? Is it right or not? No. We cannot see our face. Then how we keep our head straight? Because there are two canals and there is a liquid in these canals. So when the balance is not right, then this signal goes to the mind and the mind takes the decision, my head is in the right position or not. So because the balance was to be kept, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first blessed the human being with the ear. And in Quran, it was mentioned, فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. So the samat has been mentioned first, and the basarat has been mentioned afterwards. So it means then, there is a typical order of something, this order gives us a message. Another example from Quran, Azim al-Shan. If suppose someone wants to build a house, then he will start from the foundation. He will start from the foundation. And at the end, he will come at the roof. So start from the foundation and end up on the roof. But if he wants to demolish the building, then the order will be different. First of all, he will take out all the luminaires, tube lights, bulbs, because he wants to demolish the house. And when all the luminaires, they have been taken away, then he will demolish the roof first. And then he will come to the walls and the columns afterwards. Now this order has been observed in Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the creation of the earth and sky, He started from the earth. خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ. He described about the earth, the foundations were laid. ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. Then He mentioned the sky, it was the roof. وَجَعَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ سَقْفًا مَحْفُوظًا, because it was the roof. So first, He mentioned about the foundation, and then He mentioned about the roof. But when this building will be demolished, then the order will be different. First, luminaires will be taken out. إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُبِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ انْكَدَرَتْ. So light and bulbs, they are taken away. And then, إِذَا السَّمَاءُ انْفَطَرَتْ. Now the roof is being taken out. And then, وَإِذَا الْأَرْضُ مُدَّتْ وَأَلْقَتْ مَا فِيهَا وَتَخَلَّتْ. Came towards the foundation. So look at the beauty of Quran, that whatever word has been used, there is a reason for that. There is a secret for that. So it gives us a message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentioned the four objectives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and He changed the order of the word, there is a message. And it indicates the importance of tazkiya nafs. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Now with tilawat-e-iman, we get our iman. And after the iman, we have to work for our tazkiya nafs. Because without tazkiya nafs, you cannot get the knowledge of the book and cannot get hikmat from the Quran. So that's why it was important, it was preferred. It is so important. And it is mandatory for each and every one of us. It's not only necessary for the ulama or the sulaha. No. For each and every person, every common person, me and you, it's mandatory. We have to make our tazkiya nafs. How we should make it? There is a procedure for that. For example, if you want to clean the clothes, there's a different procedure. Apply soap and water and you can wash it. The dust will be separated from the cloth. But if you want to take away impurity from the gold, then washing cannot do the job. The procedure is different. What the jeweler will do? He will melt the gold. And when the gold will be melted, the impurities will be separated. So different procedure. Similarly, to take away impurities from the nafs, there is a certain procedure. And that procedure is that in this world, if we sit down in the company of sadiqeen, if we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excessively, if we follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we lead our life according to taqwa, all of these amal, they will help in achieving the tazkiya nafs. So this is an easy way to obey the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in this way, to clean the impurity of the inner self. How sad it is that in the modern world, people have made ministries for the pollution control. And for internal pollution control, is there any ministry? And this internal pollution is with everyone. Right from the doorstep of the masjid, you go out of the masjid and right from the street, you start getting the pollution if you don't have the control on your glances. There are so many doors of pollution. We can get pollution from the ear, from the eyes, from the mouth, from the brain. We can get pollution. So we have to control these gateways to protect our inner self from the pollution. So this is called tazkiya nafs and it is mandatory for everyone. So the first way is to achieve tazkiya nafs with the help of dhikr and in the company of the zakireen. This is the first way. And second procedure is that if we will not achieve tazkiya nafs in this world, and suppose someone, he dies with his sins without making tawbah, without achieving tazkiya nafs, then because he recited kalima, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his tazkiya nafs on the day of judgment. Tazkiya nafs will be made on the day of judgment. You know, if someone is sick, what we do in this world, we admit him in the hospital. So the person who has not achieved tazkiya nafs, he is spiritually sick. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also made a hospital for them. The name of the hospital is Jahannam. whenever someone is to be admitted in the hospital, there is always an emergency room. Every patient is first taken to the emergency room. So the grave is an emergency room for the person. So if the person, he died without making tawbah, died with a heap of sins on his head, his grave will be an emergency room for his treatment. What the people do in the emergency room? They take a very brief history, what happened, and then they start giving some treatment till the physician will come and he will take the detailed history and then he will decide where this patient is going to be admitted. So when this person, he will be put in the grave, then two angels will come. This is the staff of the emergency room. And they will ask three very small short questions. Man Rabbuk, Man Nabiyuk, Ma Deenuk. And from these three very short questions, they will come to know what type of patient he is. And then they will start giving him the treatment right from that point. And what will be the treatment? Number one, the grave will sukil them, their bones. Like if you have pain in your leg, so the people, they come to you to make your khidmat. Mutthi chaapi karte hain. So kabar bhi mutthi chaapi karegi. But that will be something different. One side of the bone will go on the other side. And in the emergency room, normally, they give intravenous injection. Drop by drop, it goes in the body until the main physician comes. So there will be a snake in the grave. It has been reported in a hadith. Now this snake will bite this person and put a drop of poison in the body. And again, after some time, again he will bite it. It will bite and give drop by drop the poison. And when the poison will go inside the body, this person will feel lot of pain. But this is treatment. It will continue till the day of judgment. And on the day of judgment, this patient will be presented in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the detailed history. So the question will be, how you spent your lifetime, how you spent your time of youth, where from you earned your money and where did you spend it, how much you acted upon your own knowledge. So this is a detailed history about the life profile. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he will decide what type of patient he is and in which section he has to be admitted. In the hospital, there are different sections. There is one normal section, and then there is ECU, extensive care ward. And then there is tertiary care unit. So the patients who have long-term diseases, they are sent to tertiary care unit because they will stay there for maybe few years. And those people who have very serious diseases, they are admitted in extensive care unit. More staff is there to take care of them. And if the disease is normal, not so big, then he is admitted in the normal ward. So similarly, there will be different wards of the Jahannam. They have been divided into 7 different wards. The tertiary care unit of this hospital will be the lowest one. And who will be admitted there? Munafiq. Innal munafiqina fi darkil asfali minan nar. He will be in the lowest zone of Jahannam. Then there will be mushrikeen. Then there will be kuffar. Why? Because they have the diseases which have no cure. So they have to stay خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا مَا دَامَتِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ. They have to stay there forever. They will never be taken out. And it's a law. If you have a room and you have different things to store in that room, then if you don't need a thing frequently, you put it on the remote corner. And the thing?
NPN. NPN 22882. Camera, please remove NPN 22882.
Some car has to be removed. It's blocking the way, maybe. So, if you don't need the thing frequently, you put it on the remote corner. And if you need it frequently or you need it after some time, then you put it near the door. Similarly, mushrikeen, munafiqeen and kuffar, they will be put in the remote end of the Jahannam. But those mu'mins, who will be mu'mins, but they had committed sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep them on the first part of Jahannam. The name of that part is Jahannam. They will be near the door, because they will be taken away after some time. But in every hospital there is a rule that there is a special costume for the dress for the patients. If you have to admit some patient, they will say, take your dress away and you have to wear our dress. This is our uniform. So for the Jahannam, there is a uniform. Sarabiluhum min qatiranin. That will be made of sulfur. In ulama, they have written that it will have such a bad smell that if all the human beings, animals, birds, all living species, they die at one place and their dead body becomes rotten, whatever bad smell will be there, the bad smell in the uniform of Jahannam will be more than that. So the person will have to wear this much of uniform. Today, we look for perfume. It is koram. It is poison. So what will happen if we have to wear the uniform of Jahannam, which will be so bad smelling? I think the person, he will be suffocating. It will be difficult for him to even breathe. If some donkey is dead in some place and you happen to pass by, even you cannot smell. You keep your breath until you pass from that place. So if one donkey has such a bad smell, then all the species of the world, if they die and then their dead body become rotten, what bad smell will be there? And then this person, he will be admitted in the hospital. And he will be given treatment according to his disease. For example, in this world, if some person is diabetic, he is not allowed to eat the sweet things. And a person, if he has high cholesterol, he is not allowed to eat the fat, the creamy thing. And if he has blood pressure, is not allowed to eat the food with salt. And he has to eat the food which is made with steam. No taste at all. Sometimes even bad taste, but he has to eat it because he is patient. So this person in Jahannam will be given a food like that. What will be the food? In Nasharat al-Zakum, Ta'am al-Asir, Kal-Muhl Yakhli fil-Butun, Kaghal Yilham. Zakum will be given to them. It will be so bad taste that when he will eat it, he will neither be able to swallow it nor will be able to take it out. He will be even more trouble. And then he will beg for water from the angels. Give me something to drink. But you know, the patients, they are not allowed to drink everything. If he has cold, he is not allowed to drink cold water. And if he is diabetes, not allowed to drink juices. So maybe just water, tap water he has to eat, he has to drink without any taste. He has to drink it. Although he is sweating, but he is not allowed to take juices and not allowed to take cold drinks. Similarly, this person because he is patient. Then he will ask something to drink. What he will be given? He will be given something very bad taste. What? The pus and the blood which will come out from the wounds of the Jahannami people, it will be collected at one place and put in glasses and it will be served to these patients. And they will eat it. They will drink it. لا يأكله إلا الخاطئون. That will be the drink from Quran given to the people. And the person who will have bad thoughts in his mind. There are youngsters, they sit down and they normally keep bad thoughts in their mind and they enjoy. If this will be the case, then hot water will be poured on their head. يُصَبُّ مِنْ فَوْقِ رُؤُوتِهِمُ الْحَمِيمِ. This will be a treatment given to them. Like you go to the doctor and you are diabetes, he will tell you have to take bath with warm water every day. So this is a treatment. So the person who will have bad thoughts always in his mind, nafsani khayshat, gande khayalat, shahwani khayalat, gande mansoobe bandenge, yutabbu min fawqihimul hameed. Hot water will be poured on their heads. It will be a treatment. And the person who will tease others, give pain to them, who will look at the shortcomings of others and will separate them in the community because they will give pain to the hearts of the other, so they will be treated especially. There will be a special section. Its name will be Wail. Wailul likulli humazatil lumaza. So he will be taken there and fastened with a column of fire. And then there will be a special fire and it will work as a guided missile, guided rocket. You know there are guided rockets, they go up to the target. So similarly, Narullah, there will be a fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it will rise from some place and it will hit the heart of that person directly. Guided rockets will be showered upon his heart. Narullahil muqada allati tattaliu ala al-afida. All of them, they will make the heart of the person target. And then there will be some person, they will not give zakat. So they will also be treated. All the gold and silver will be converted into bars and it will be heated in the fire of Jahannam, and then the forehead and the side and the back, it will be, they will be put on the body, parts of the body. Like if some person has pain, the doctors recommend that you should have hot water. They have rubber bottle, put hot water and then they put it on the place where there is some pain. So similarly, these bars of gold and silver, they will be made hot and put on the forehead, put on the side, put on the back. It's treatment. And Hazrat Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani rahmatullah alayhi quoted in Ghuniyat al-Talibin that those persons who will commit zina in this world and will die without making true tawbah, then they will also be treated specially. There will be a cave. This person will be pushed in the cave and the door will be closed. And there will be scorpion. And those scorpion will come and they will come and sting on the body of the person as the honeybee sits on their own nest. all the body will be covered with the scorpion. Indeed, thousands and thousands of scorpions will bite him at one time. Because he enjoyed a sin. And every tissue of the body enjoyed it. So that's why the medicine has to go in each and every tissue. So this will be a treatment for them. So after some time, when this person will get the treatment, what do you mean by treatment? Sufficient punishment. Then he will be taken out from the hell and then he will be taken to the paradise. Because there is a rule in Quran that the paradise is the place for those people who have achieved tazkiyah. It's in Quran, Azim al-Shan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has quoted the explanation of the paradise and then at the end has concluded, وَذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ مَن تَزَكَّى. And this is the reward for that person who got the tazkiyah. So it's a rule. No person without tazkiyah will be allowed to enter in paradise. And we can see in this world, for example, you want to go to perform Hajj and Umrah. It's a requirement from the Saudi embassy that you should have treatment against cholera and meningitis. If someone wants to migrate to some country, then they say that you have to give us your medical report. You will be tested against EHV positive. You will be tested against some other diseases. So the countries, they require that the person who is entering in our territory must be free from sicknesses and illnesses. So if the countries of the world, they require in this world, this is the requirement by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that paradise is a place for my pious, beloved people. Any person who has to enter in, he should have a proper treatment before for the sicknesses, and that the tazkiyah nafs for the person. Without tazkiyah nafs, no one will be allowed to enter. I know one person, he got his good job in the Emirates, but in his medical report, there was some sickness, hepatitis C. So when the doctor looked at hepatitis C, he rejected. Although he was fully educated, experienced, very distinguished engineer, but because he had hepatitis C, his application was rejected. Then I recalled at that time, oh Allah, look at these people. They don't allow anyone with the disease to enter in their country, or you will allow anyone to enter in the paradise with the disease. So it's mandatory upon us to achieve tazkiyah nafs. There are two routes. Number one, to achieve the tazkiyah nafs and sit down in the company of the ulama, sulaha, mashayikh, and to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excessively. This is so easy. And if we will not do that, then the next line is that tazkiyah will be made on the day of judgment. And there will be few people, kafir, mushrik, munafiq, their tazkiyah will not be made on the day of Jahannam. From Quran, Azim Shan, La yukallimuhum Allahu yawm al-qiyamah وَلَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَيْهِمْ. And at the other place, وَلَا يُزَكِّيهِمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not make tazkiyah of them. So this word, وَلَا يُزَكِّيهِمْ from Quran proves that tazkiyah will be made on the day of judgment. How it will be made? It will be made by the fire of Jahannam. We are so delicate people, we cannot stand in the hotness of the sun. Will it be easy for us to go in the flame of the fires of the hell? When we come out in the summer season from outside to the house, then we demand from our wife ice cold water. If she presents tap water, we can throw it away. We need ice cold water. I'm sweating. So we grew up with this much ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we will be offered ghisleen in Jahannam, وَلَا تَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ ghisleen. Ghisleen means the pus and blood came from the wounded wounds of the Jahannami people. So how we will be able to drink it? So we have to think. The easy route is to achieve tazkiyah nafs in this world. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to work on ourselves, to clean our inner self from the pollution of the sin. And nowadays, the name of the person is Ibrahim. But if you see his takabbur, he is more than Namrud. The name of the person is Musa. And if you look at his zulm, he will be even more than Fir'aun. The name of the person will be Ghulam Rasool. But you look at his life, he will be acting like Abu Jahl, such a bi'adab and gustakh. So just by keeping Muslim names, will we go into the paradise? No. By being a Muslim, by getting the capabilities in ourselves, then we will be allowed to enter into the paradise. So, how we can get the key enough in this world? By making effort. But are these efforts sufficient? No. We have to make effort. And then, the result is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَوْلَا فَضُلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ مَا زَكَى مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ أَبَدًا وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهُ يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. So we cannot achieve tazkiyah ourselves. We have just to make effort. The example is that when the father has a small son, then he keeps him standing at a distant place, few feet away, and then asks him, come to me. The father knows that this small child has not the capability to reach me. But what he requires? He requires, he should try to come towards me, and he knows that when he will be unbalanced, I will not let him down, I will catch him, and I will embrace him. So similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that these human beings, they cannot achieve tazkiyah nafs with their own mujahida and amal. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that they should act something. They should try to take some steps, try to do something. And when they will take the step with ikhlas and sincerity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let us down. He will take us in His arms and He will take us to His death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be a good mu'min and to be a person by whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. سبحان ربي العلى الرحاب اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اے مالک ہم آپ کے عاجز مسکین بندے ہیں ہمارے گناہوں کو معاف فرما ہماری خطاؤں سے درگزر فرما ہمارے عیبوں کی پردہ پوشی فرما اے مالک ہماری نگاہوں کو پاک فرما ہمارے دلوں کو صاف فرما ہمارے سینوں کو اپنی محبت سے لبریز فرما اپنے عشق کی آتش ہمارے سینوں میں پیدا فرما اے مالک ہمارے اے اللہ ہمیں برے دن سے محفوظ فرما بری رات سے محفوظ فرما برے وقت سے محفوظ فرما برے کاموں سے محفوظ فرما برے دوستوں سے محفوظ فرما اللہ ہمیں برے انجام سے محفوظ فرما ہدایت ملنے کے بعد گمراہی سے محفوظ فرما عزت ملنے کے بعد ذلت سے محفوظ فرما اللہ ہمیں سیدھا رستہ ملنے کے بعد بھٹکنے سے محفوظ فرما ڈگمگانے سے محفوظ فرما پھسلنے سے محفوظ فرما نفس شیطان کے مکر و فریب سے محفوظ فرما اے مالک ہمارے ایمان کی حفاظت فرما اللہ جو گناہ ہم نے دن میں کیے وہ معاف فرما جو راتوں میں کیے معاف فرما جو محفل میں کیے معاف فرما، جو تنہائیوں میں کیے معاف فرما، اللہ جو ارادے سے گناہ کیے وہ بھی معاف فرما، جو بنا ارادے کے ہوئے وہ بھی معاف فرما، اللہ جو گناہ ہمیں یاد ہیں وہ بھی معاف فرما، جو کر کے بھول چکے وہ گناہ بھی معاف فرما، رب کریم رحمت کا معاملہ فرما، اے اللہ ہم عاجز مسکینوں کا تزکیہ فرما، اے اللہ ہمارے باطن کو صاف فرما، رب کریم ہم بھولے بھٹکے رہے گناہ کرتے پھرے، اے اللہ رمضان مبارک کی ان بابرکت گھڑیوں میں ہم آپ سے معافی کے طلبگار ہیں، دامن پھیلا دیے ہیں، اللہ ہمیں معاف فرما دیجئے، اللہ معاف فرما دیجئے، اے اللہ جو بندے دوسروں کی غلطیوں کو معاف کرتے ہوں، عافین عن الناس ہو، آپ تو ان سے پیار کرتے ہیں، تو آپ خود کتنا معاف فرمانے والے ہیں، اللہ معاف فرما دیجئے، ہماری کوتاہیوں سے درگزر فرما دیجئے، رب کریم آپ نے ارشاد فرمایا وَأَمَّا الصَّائِمَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ، اور سائل کو جھڑکی نہ دو، انکار نہ کرو، جب ہم کمزوروں کو حکم ہے کہ ہم سائل کو انکار نہ کریں، اللہ ہم بھی تو آپ کے در کے سائل ہیں، آپ بھی انکار نہ فرمائیے، اے مالک آپ نے ارشاد پر اے مالک ہمیں شریعت کا یہ حکم ملا کہ مزدور کو پسینہ خشک ہونے سے پہلے مزدوری دینی ضروری ہوتی ہے، اے مالک آپ کے بندوں نے سارا دن روزہ رکھا، اللہ افطاری کا وقت قریب ہے، اللہ یہ مزدور بھی آپ سے آپ کی رضا چاہتے ہیں، اے مالک رحمت فرما دیجئے، اللہ ہماری مزدوری اگر کسی کام کی نہیں مگر آپ تو امیدوں سے زیادہ عطا کرنے والے ہیں، اے مولا عطا کر دیجئے، رب کریم افطاری کے وقت دعائیں قبول ہونے کی خوشخبری آپ کے محبوب نے عطا کی ہوئی ہے، اللہ ہماری دعاؤں کو قبول فرما لیجئے اور ہمیں اپنا بنا لیجئے، اے اللہ امت مسلمہ کو عزت رفتہ نصیب فرما، اے اللہ ہمارے مجاہدین بھائیوں کی مدد فرما، اے اللہ ان کی پشت پناہی فرما، کفر کا منہ کالا فرما، ان کی صفوں میں انتشار پیدا فرما، اے اللہ ہماری ان دعاؤں کو اپنی رحمت سے قبول فرما، اے اللہ جہاں جہاں تک آواز جا رہی ہے ہر سننے والے یا سننے والی کو اللہ اپنے مقرب بندے اور بندیوں میں شامل فرما، جو مانگا وہ بھی عطا فرما، جو مانگنا چاہیے تھا نہیں مانگ سکے وہ بھی عطا فرما، اے اللہ جنہوں نے ہمیں دعاؤں کے لیے کہا، فون کیے، خط لکھے، یا جن سے ہم نے وعدے کیے، یا جو ہم سے امید کرتے ہیں، یا جن کے ہمارے اوپر حقوق آتے ہیں، ان سب کو ان دعاؤں میں شامل فرما، اے اللہ ہمارے والدین، عزیز اقارب، مشائخ سے دنیا سے رخصت ہو چکے، ان سب کی مغفرت فرما، اور جن کی آپ نے مغفرت کر دی قرب کے اعلیٰ درجات عطا فرما، رب کریم اس میں سے پہلے ہم سب کے گناہوں کو معاف فرما، اے اللہ ہم ناز نعمت کے پلے بندے ہیں، ہم سے تو دھوپ کی گرمی برداشت نہیں ہوتی، جہنم کی گرمی کہاں برداشت ہوگی، رب کریم رحمت فرما دیجئے اور ہمارے حال پر رحمت کی نظر ڈال دیجئے، اللہ ہماری ان دعاؤں کو اپنی رحمت سے قبول فرما، ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم، تب علینا انک انت التواب الرحیم، صلی اللہ تعالی علی خیر خلقہ سیدنا محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ اجمعین برحمتک یا ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین، ارحم الراحمین.